Hello, my name is Grace and I'm part of the HURIDOCS team. Today I'd like to walk you through the process of designing your conceptual data model. So what is a conceptual data model and why is it important? Well, a conceptual data model is a high-level description of the informational needs underlying the design of your database. In other words, a conceptual data model, which usually takes the form of a flowchart or a diagram, can represent the main concepts present in your information system and the important relationships between these concepts. As you sort through all of the information you have collected, creating a data model can help you to answer the questions that you want to be able to ask of your information system and understand real-world relationships better. Now, you may be wondering what you should include in your data model. Well, there are three basic components to any data model. First are the entities. These are the real-life things, like people, places, or events that your database contains information about. Then there are the relationships. These describe how your different entities are associated with each other. Often, the relationships in your data model will reflect the real-life relationships between the people, institutions, objects, or events described in your data. Finally, your conceptual data model should also include the attributes of your entities. Attributes are the characteristics which describe the people, objects, or events described in your database. Ultimately, your conceptual data model should take the shape of a diagram with your entities, relationships, and attributes clearly defined. Let's look at an example to illustrate these key components of your conceptual data model. Let's say an organization wants to answer this question: how many prisoners are illegally detained in each prison in country X? To answer this, an appropriate conceptual data model will include at least two entities, like prisoner and prison, for example. These entities will be connected by a relationship, a real-life connection which bridges them. In this case, the relationship describes how the prisoner is detained in the prison. Branching from each entity are the different attributes which describe the respective entities. Some of the attributes this organization might want to capture for the prisoner are the date of detention, the sex, the nationality, or the charges. For the prison, some attributes might be the name, the country of jurisdiction, and the location. Now that you have learned about the different components of a conceptual data model, let's explore the steps to developing your own model. You may already have some kind of system in place, or perhaps you have been thinking of a data model to organize your information. You may already have a lot of information to work with, or you may be just starting to think about what information you need to collect. Whatever stage you're in, going through the steps of thinking through your conceptual data model can be helpful to understanding the information you have and what else you need. The first step is to identify your entities. In the human rights field, projects will often document information about victims, acts of human rights violation, laws, courts, prisons, and more. To begin brainstorming your entities, ask yourself, what are the real-life things, people, objects, institutions, or events that we are asking questions about? It might help you to write down the questions you want your information to answer. Then, underline the nouns in your questions. These just might be your entities. Take, for example, our organization wondering about how many prisoners are illegally detained in country X. They collect data in prisoner forms like this one, where they record each prisoner's name, birth date, birthplace, passport number, sex, place of detention, date of detention, and profession. When the organization wants to determine their entities, they ask themselves, what are the real-life things, people, objects, institutions, or incidents that we are asking questions about? In this case, there are two entities that stand out in this information. Kevin Costa, the prisoner, is one entity, and the prison, Lima City Prison, is the second entity. The next step is to draw the relationships that you want to examine between your identified entities. How are your entities related to each other? There are many possible relationships, but you should ensure that those you create in your information system are simple and reflect real-life relationships as much as possible. If you're having trouble understanding the relationships between your entities, try using the sentence formula entity, verb, entity. For example, one relationship related to human rights violations might include a victim who was involved in an act or an incident. Another is a firm which exploited its workers, or a perpetrator who was involved in an event or an incident. Or perhaps a person is a member of a group. For our organization wondering about how many prisoners are illegally detained in country X, they have already determined the entities Kevin Costa and Lima City Prison. The relationship that connects the entities would be is detained in. The final step is to identify your attributes. Technically speaking, an attribute identifies, names, and defines a characteristic or property of an entity and determines the fields of a database. To identify your attributes, ask yourself, what are the characteristics of each entity that you must know about your entities in order to answer your database queries? Our organization, interested in identifying how many prisoners are illegally detained in country X, can identify the attributes of their entities from the information collected. For example, a prisoner, Kevin Costa, has important attributes including date of birth, date detained, sex, and profession. A prison, similarly, has important attributes such as name, location, and country of jurisdiction. The name is Lima City Prison. Even though some of this information is not immediately available on the prisoner form, a bit of research can tell us the prison's location is Lima, metropolitan area, and that the country of jurisdiction is Peru. At this point, our organization has identified its entities, drawn its relationships, and identified its attributes. And you can do the same. Now that you know the steps to building out a conceptual data model, you can begin to puzzle out the pieces to your own data model. We know this process is not the easiest or most intuitive, but this nitty-gritty technical side of managing human rights information is what will allow us to use it in the most helpful way. Ultimately, we hope this video helps you think more about how your current information management system works and how you can strengthen it. If you have thoughts or questions about designing your conceptual data model, or would like to see a similar video on another topic related to preparing for a database, get in touch. From all of us here at HURIDOCS, thank you.